So when I was a new and somewhat naive priest in charge of my first church, one of the matriarchs of the church of the parish challenged me in front of a group of people on a delicate and divisive topic. My response at the time was not helpful, and it left me feeling very demoralized, and also that thing where you go back and you think, I could have said that. If only I'd said that, I should have said that. And maybe you've been in that position too. A witty, sharp, intelligent response, but the moment's passed. But not so with Jesus, what we read this morning. He didn't need to think up a response. He didn't come up with a witty rebuff. Instead, a question, which was usually the way he responded. A question to a question. So let's just look at what was happening there. He'd been teaching in the temple and telling parables, like the one that we heard last week that Bishop Robertson so helpfully unpacked for us. And when the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered in the temple and heard those parables, they realized that he was speaking about them, and they wanted to arrest him. But they feared the crowds that were around him, because the crowds regarded Jesus, Matthew tells us, as a prophet. So instead, off they went, and they plotted to entrap Jesus and send some of their disciples, some of the Pharisees' disciples, and the Herodians to do that deed. And the Herodians, by the way, were part of the Herodian dynasty. They were supporters of the Herods. They would have been supporters of the Herod who killed all the children, you know, when Jesus was born, and later would just have very little to do with our Lord being crucified. But the Herodians were currying favor with the Romans and keeping kind of, you know, making sure they were comfortable. So this group, this unlikely group, come and a teacher, they say, and you can imagine it in your own voice. I'm just saying how I hear it. We know you're sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with the truth and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? And their purpose, you understand, was to put Jesus between a rock and a hard place here. The issue of paying taxes was a hot topic. In his commentary on Matthew, Bishop N.T. Wright asks, how would we feel it if we woke up one morning and discovered that the people from the other end of the world had marched into our country, demanded we pay them tax as a reward for having land stolen? We don't have to think very hard about that. What that might feel like. And he adds, when Jesus was a child, a Jewish leader had led a revolt precisely against this paying of Roman taxes. The Romans had crushed it mercilessly, leaving crosses around the countryside for people to see what happened if you didn't pay taxes. And our Lord would have grown up having seen that. The dead and dying revolutionaries, a warning that paying tax was compulsory and not optional. So on that background, we can see how them coming together, how is our Lord going to respond? And the crowd who are gathered around him, who have so many expectations about what Jesus is going to do, the new kingdom overthrowing the Romans, wouldn't they expect that he would oppose the tax? Wouldn't that be what they were hoping and expecting, to lift that weight of Roman rule off their shoulders? But Jesus doesn't fall into the trap that the Pharisees have set for him. And instead, he calls them hypocrites, doesn't mince words. I would think sometimes we forget that when we sort of say, Jesus, meek and mild. Yeah. He then says them, okay, bring me one of those coins, a denarii, that's used for paying tax. And they hand it to him. First of all, why did they even have one of those coins? Why were they carrying them? They were supposed to be given back to Caesar. They weren't supposed to be carrying them. And what devout Jew would be carrying a coin that had an image on it? They were commanded not to do so. And that image was the image of Caesar. And around the edge, Son of God, High Priest, an image rather of the Emperor. Yeah, these coins belong to Caesar. A normal, everyday coin had no image. So our Lord takes the denarii that they've given them and asks them, whose head is on this? And the response, obviously, is the Emperor's. And so he responds, as we heard, give the Emperor what belongs to him, and to God the things that are God's. Essentially, he's saying there's no room for duplicity. He's not saying don't pay taxes, but he is saying, he is asking, where is your allegiance? Who are you following? And it ties in with the lesson from last week. It ties in with that, what we heard about turning up at the banquet, going through the motions, or going to the temple, giving the appearance of faith, faithfulness to God, but the heart's not in it. Oh, I have a blank piece of paper. I wonder what our Lord wanted to say there. Okay. In the reading from 1 Thessalonians, St. Paul writes to the church in Thessalonica, giving thanks and praying for them, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. And he comments that when they heard the word, it was in the power of the Holy Spirit with full conviction despite persecution. The church heard the word and took it seriously. The gospel was seared in their hearts. Brothers and sisters, beloved of God, wrote Paul from his prison cell, we know that God has chosen you. And just so, we are called to use our gifts for the spreading of the gospel, which can be done in so many ways and which so many of you do, in word and in deed, how we live, how we treat one another. And if our hearts are not in it and we're just going through the motions, it is clear to God at least that our clothes, we may as well be just wearing shabby clothes to come to that banquet that we've been all invited to. And there's nothing wrong with clothes that you haven't had time or a place to wash them, but instead clothes that represent a lack of interest and commitment. It doesn't deceive God. Throughout his ministry, our Lord will ask, will you follow? Will you follow? I was at Wycliffe College last week where I trained and in the chapel, and I spent many hours in there, and on one of the glass windows there, one of the stained glass windows, says, follow me, is right there. I mean, you're just reminded every time you go, this is who we follow. This is who we follow. So Jesus asked, where's your allegiance? Is it with the Romans? Keep nice and comfortable, safe? Or is it with Jesus, where there may be hunger, imprisonment, persecution, and death? And persecution of Christians has continued to this day. Many, many thousands. In her prayer on Friday night at Wycliffe College, Bishop Jenny Anderson, thank God that those of us who could pray in safety, we sort of take it for granted. We're not really expecting, are we, rebels to come marching in and cart us off to jail because we're meeting in the name of the Lord? But many have witnessed that. And we've witnessed the horrors that we're seeing now in the Middle East, endured by Christians, but by Jews and by Muslims. The earth on which we tread has absorbed the blood of God's beloved and created humanity since the moment that Cain murdered his brother. Brother against brother, family against family, tribe against tribe, country against country, and the blooded land continues to cry out. And what we're seeing right now, what is happening in the Middle East, doesn't stay there because the media, unwittingly or otherwise, by showing this, spreads that so people can see. I have a Jewish school, I think I've mentioned it, just down the road from where I live. It now has a police car outside it all the time. We know of the Muslim family that were mowed down by an angry young man in a car. The British media reports that between the 1st and the 18th of October in London, England, there have been 218 anti-Semitic incidents, up from 15 from last year, and 101 Islamophobia incidents, up from 42 last year. So that hatred and anger is being spread through the world. Jesus holds up a coin and says, "Who will you follow? Yes, follow the laws of your country, but where is your heart? I am the way, the truth, and the life," he said. "For this world now, and for the kingdom of God, where we follow his example with forgiveness, where arms are laid down, where the sword is forever turned into a plow to prepare the blood-soaked soil for seed to grow new life, to spread in abundance." To follow Jesus means to follow him, to look to him, and more personally, to seek God's help so that we can let go of that anger and forgiveness in our hearts. When we see that stuff on the TV, don't you feel your outrage rising? And what can we do? We can pray, we can pray, we can pray, and hold it up. When our Lord calls us to turn, it's to turn our whole lives to him, to pray and to read scripture, to study, not with one foot in and one foot out. "Well, I'm sort of a Christian. I show up at church sometimes." Jesus knew the Pharisees and those Herodians, not all the ones who had come were hypocrites, and he called them out. But heaven forbid that we would stand before our Lord and he would say, "I do not know you. Did you give a cup of water to someone who was thirsty?" Can't work our way into God's favor. He loves us all, but he requires our love and commitment. Jesus was not intimidated by that cunning trap that was set for him. He'd already spoken about his impending death. He knew what was waiting for him. But his death was not the last word. And that's what we celebrate. The kingdom of God would defeat the kingdom of Caesar, not by conventional means, but by the victory of God's love and power over the even greater empire of death itself. And this is the God who asks us, "Will you follow me? Will you follow me? King of kings, Lord of